3, 4.
Welcome to worship at church and online. I'm Pastor Maria. Pastor Kiri is off today, and thank you to Abby, one of our young people who's serving as worship assistant this morning. And thank you also to Alicia Noreen for agreeing to be interviewed for the message today as part of our interview series. She stayed, so that's good. The first service didn't scare her off. So we look forward to hearing from you at this service as well. Thank you so much. If you are new to Our Saviors, we would love to connect with you. You're invited to fill out a connection card. You can find those in the pew rack in front of you or on the church website under Connect. I've got one announcement to highlight for you from your weekly announcement sheet. Preparations are underway for Vacation Bible School. VBS will be August 5th through 8th, Monday through Thursday in the mornings. So now is the time to get those registrations in for the kids in your life and to let us know if you can volunteer. Volunteers can be adults or youth who have completed sixth grade or older. And we know life is busy, so thank you in advance for considering helping out 1, 2, 3, or all 4 days for VBS. For more information, you can check out the details in the announcements on the church website, or you can talk to Alicia, the director of CYF Ministries. I do also have some sad news this morning. One of our members, Terrence Burtson, passed away last week, and his funeral will be here on Wednesday at 11 o'clock with visitation 1 hour prior. So please keep his wife, Lorelei, and their family in your prayers at this time. As we move into worship now, I invite you to stand as you are able and from your spot share a word or a wave of peace with everyone around.
Please remain standing as we sing our opening song, Evidence. Christian doesn't mean that Jesus is going to make our lives completely 100% pain or suffering free, but it does mean that he gives us little blessings and he walks alongside us as we travel this life, and for that we bless him. So let's sing Bless God.
Seeking
Jesus, we bless you every day for all the gifts you continue to pour on us. Thank you for guiding us through life and giving each of us a story to share. Continue to show us the path and the plans that you have for us. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
And it is time for the children's message. So kids, come on up. I've got the milk can if you brought offering. And you might notice I have a friend up here helping today. Dun, dun, dun. All right. I think we've got the gang. Here they come. All right. Well, good morning. Good to see you guys. Well, my friend Abby is helping lead worship today, so I thought I would have her help us out. So, I brought something. What do you think I'm going to use this for with my friend Abby? Any ideas? Make her like a stuntman. Wow, we didn't talk about that possibility. Oh, a snowman. Okay, I was like, stuntman, we're having her flying from the ceiling. That'd be cool. Work on that, Jennifer. Get a Peter Pan. Yeah. Well, actually, I'm going to use this as a blindfold. Okay, so Abby, my plan is to take you on a little trip around the room this morning, but you won't have to, you won't be able to see where you're going. Is that okay?
Yeah, let's do it.
All right, she's game. We love that. Thank you for being willing. Let's have you stand up. Mm-hmm. Actually, you're tall. Maybe step down a step. Let's see how this goes. Thank you. Oh, she's so kind. Okay, let's see if we can do this without messing up her hair too much, because we try to be nice. I'll try not to pull. All right. All right, can you see?
Nope.
Fantastic. She cannot see. All right, so we'll see how this goes. You don't have to worry about getting lost. I've got you, okay?
Thanks.
All right, so up the step. Let's see. Oh, Larry moved. I was maybe going to have you go around Larry. That was part of my plot. Let's see. There's a step coming, so up the step. Let's see. All right, we're going to have to, all right, beware of plant on your right. Okay, but don't hit the altar on your left. Okay, there you go. See, we'll let you know where you are. Okay, we're going. Can we go faster? We can go faster. Okay, another corner. Look out for the candle and the plant. Yep. All right. All right, we got it, and we're not going to knock over Julie's guitar. Okay, now we're going to go down the step. There you go. You got it. We're good. Okay. All right, and we're back where we started. You can take off the blindfold. All right. Nice work, Abby.
Thank you.
Woohoo. Yeah. Well, so how did that feel? Like, was that scary? Was it fun?
It was fun.
It was fun? Okay, nice.
Very fun.
Is her mic working, Laura? It is.
Should be on.
Okay. There we go. Okay, fantastic. Well, thank you for being willing to do that. Wow, I'm really loud. So it was fun. Good. I'm glad it was fun. And that was quite the adventure, wasn't it? Yep. So I was helping to guide Abby on her adventure so she would know which way to go. And she trusted me to do that, right? Yep. Well, life is kind of an adventure. And all through the Bible, there are stories of God promising to guide people through their lives and then doing it. And God guides us through life too. In fact, there's a Bible verse that says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and he will make your paths straight." Now, I know that Abby is going to start her last year of high school soon, and she is trying to decide where to go to college. That is the next step on her adventure. So I thought I would ask, Abby, how are you choosing where to go to college, and how are you hoping God will guide you in that whole process?
So there's a lot to choose in college. I have to figure out financially how expensive different colleges are. I have to figure out how far away from home it is and what kind of classes they have. And one of the ways that I've been finding peace is praying to God, especially in group prayer. I have a group called Girls in God, which is with a bunch of girls around my age, where we pray about that stuff and hope that we'll be guided to find the right college and the right path for ourselves after high school.
That's very cool, and that makes a lot of sense. You know, God guides us in all sorts of ways. God gives us brains to think things through, right? And look at the things like finances and how far things are from home. God gives us people to talk to, trusted people to talk with. You know, you've got friends that you can pray with, and I'm sure you're talking to your family, too, about how this is all going to work out. That time in prayer when we're quiet and we're talking with God, that's when God kind of nudges us and lets us know what to do, which way to go next on our adventure of life. So one day, this will be you guys. One day you'll be deciding what to do after high school. These days, you guys are probably trying to figure out things like, well, what sport should I try next? You know, maybe I haven't tried softball or baseball or soccer, and maybe you're thinking through some of those things. Or maybe it's summertime. Maybe you're thinking through, what book do I want to read next on my summer break? That was always me as a kid. So here's what I want you to know. At every single step in life's adventure, God is with you, okay? In life, we don't always know where we're going. But when we trust God to lead us to the next step, just that next step, we'll always end up in just the right place. So let's pray together. Let's fold our hands and you can repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for being with us.
Thank you for guiding us through life.
We're so glad we can trust you to lead us. So glad we can trust you to lead us. We look forward to the adventure you have in store. Look forward to the adventure you have in store. Lead on, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Awesome. Thanks for coming up, and thank you to Abby for helping. If you are first grade or younger, you can head out the back door with Madison to Kids Time, and you'll come back during the next song, and the rest of you can head back to where you're sitting. Thanks for coming up.
It's always fascinating to hear about other people's lives and their faith. In the interview series, we get to do just that. It's an opportunity to discover more about a few familiar faces at our Savior's. It's an opportunity to reflect on how God has been active in their lives. Turns out, we all have a story to share.
Well, our scripture for this morning is from the book of Proverbs. We've got two passages from Proverbs today. The first is from the 19th chapter. Many are the plans in a person's heart, but it is the Lord's purpose that prevails. That's one you'll probably take home today, huh, Abby? And from Proverbs 3, trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not rely on your own insight. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make straight your paths. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, we are back with another installment of the interview series, and this morning we are very fortunate to have Alicia Noreen, one of our members, giving us a little bit of her life and her faith, and we'll see if we can all blink back the tears this time too. So let's start with give us a few nuggets of who you are and what brought you to our Saviors, Alicia.
Thank you. We'll see if I can do this round two. I grew up on a beef, cattle, and grain farm about 2 hours west of here. I'm the oldest child, so that came, you know, all the fun additional responsibilities of being the oldest. I also had the privilege and the unique privilege of growing up in a house of two denominations. One of my parents was Lutheran and the other was Catholic. And as we grew in our faith, our parents actually let us choose what faith denomination spoke to us the most or where we felt the most connected. Not many kids get to have that opportunity. I felt most connected to the Lutheran faith and really felt that little small town church was my place. And so I was raised confirmed Lutheran, although there were many weekends. We still attended Catholic Mass together as a family, mm-hmm. holidays, and then turn around the next morning, go to church together and worship in the Lutheran church together. One of my favorite parts about the church I grew up in, it was an ELCA Lutheran church, but we had a very active Luther League. That was our version of youth group. And when I was in, I think, ninth grade, I can't remember, it's been a couple years, I was able to attend the ELCA youth gathering in Atlanta. So our youth are currently in New Orleans trying to find their way back home. And I still remember that youth gathering that I was able to go to. And as a farm kid, we didn't get many opportunities to travel. So my church gave me the opportunity to travel outside of Minnesota for the first time in my life. That was really impressionable, and feeling everyone worship together was a really incredible experience. When I went into college, like most college kids, church isn't as easy when you're on your own and you're in a strange city and you don't know anybody. It's really intimidating to walk into a church as a young adult and think, oh, should I be here or not? I never felt comfortable. So fast forward a few years, when my husband and I landed in Bram for his work, I said, I need to be in church again. I miss this, I need that connectivity. And so we found ourselves at Bram ELCA Lutheran, the only ELCA Lutheran church up there. We attended that church for a few years, and in the meanwhile had moved down here and continued to drive up there. Now by then we had three kids, two of them are here helping today, one of them singing, it was a lot of work driving 30 plus miles with three kids, three and under. I was usually exhausted and sweaty by the time we even got to church, that I probably didn't get a lot out of it when we decided it's time to find something closer to home, because we live just a few miles north of here. I was working in Wyoming, and I was driving past the other building when we were on the other side of 65, and I said, I think that's an ELCA church. We should check that out. I'd almost get the courage, and then I'd chicken out again, because I think my college years flashed back pretty quickly to feeling uncomfortable in a new space again. So eventually we came. We were in this building at the time, and Dustin and I came, and we sat in the back, because that's what you did at that time when you had little kids that were squirrely. Sometimes they were feral, I'm pretty sure. I remember the music. I don't remember the message. Sorry, Maria. Don't remember the message as much, but I remember the music and thinking, I think we should go back sometime. That was really great. A couple of weeks later, we came back, and in typical fashion with little kids, we were late. And I quickly scanned all the back pews, and they were full. Turns out we weren't the only ones that sat in the back of little kids. And the usher said, come with me, I've got a spot for you. And I was thinking, oh good, like maybe the third pew from the back, or maybe the second pew from the back, what little corner can you tuck us in? And they brought us up here, and as we started walking forward, I looked back at Dustin, like freaked out and panicked, like, oh no, we're not doing this. I am not gonna let the whole church see how I cannot control my kids. Well, I mean, what do? You're halfway down the aisle, and I just am like, well, I don't say no in church, right? So we did. We sat up in the second pew, and it was amazing. They didn't move. It was like they had cast a spell on my kids. And I was like, oh, I think I could do this again. And guess what? That band is that same band that still, I can't look at Jennifer right now, that is such an important part of our life and has changed it for the better.
I did not know that was God's plan to be late. I mean, who isn't late? We were really late that day, and guess where we ended up? Right here where we needed to be, and that was 14 or 15 years ago.
Yeah, and you're a very good Lutheran because your instinct was to sit in the back, which is what all Lutherans do. But yeah, well, and now, see, we've all now figured it out, too. Now we have the kids in the front at the playground.
It's amazing.
It makes a difference, yeah. Tell us about a pivotal moment in your life of faith.
Similar to how Jennifer shared, maybe not a big moment. You know, when I was a teenager, I kept thinking, where's my God moment? Everyone talks about these God moments. I can't wait for mine. It was a series of little things, and looking back, it's just amazing how you don't recognize it or realize it at the time. But when I was in confirmation, one of our first sermons, see, I'm fighting tears. Thanks, Jennifer. Talked about cardboard boxes. And we were like, what does cardboard boxes have to do with God and church? I don't get it. Turns out she told us a story about a fictional town of cardboard boxes and how everyone put one another and themselves in boxes. And they were forced in, whether you wanted to be in that box or not. You were the banker, the this, the that, and you did this, and that. And her message was, that's not realistic. We're messy. And don't put yourselves and each other in boxes, because that's not how God sees you. And I remember thinking, whoa, I am a mess. Mm-hmm. And it really was important to me at that point in my impressionable teenage years to realize that I was putting myself in a box. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Now I got a big box.
Go good. Go team.
I was putting myself in a box that I didn't need to do, and putting too much pressure on myself. I really didn't fit in the greatest in high school either. I was in a small town. There weren't a lot of friend groups to choose from, and I was short. I played trumpet. I was like the only girl trumpet player for the longest time. And I had younger siblings and responsibilities and wasn't out running around town doing a lot of things the other kids did. And so I struggled for a long time to find my place. Church was my place. And I'd been trying to put myself in a box I shouldn't have been doing, which was really great for me to hear at that age. We actually asked her for an encore when we got confirmed. It wasn't quite as good as the first one, but the message carried through. The second moment for me was, and I'll keep this shorter, I had a niece who was born with a congenital heart condition that we didn't know about right away. She spent about three quarters of her first life in the hospital. We went from the wide range of she's going to not live, to she's going to need a heart transplant, to well, maybe she'll be okay, but we're not really sure. And in that course of time of having a surgery scheduled, canceled because she's sick, rescheduled back and forth, and just feeling a lot of frustration, we got towards the 8 or 9 month mark, and she went in to have her pre-op work done, and the surgeon said, I think we should postpone surgery. And my sister, lost it, because we're thinking, now what? Now why? It had been postponed so many times, and he said, the hole I'm most worried about is smaller, and I can't figure it out. I've never seen this before. And we're like, huh, okay. Well, she has gotten a little bigger. Sent her home. We came back a month later, and they said, we're canceling her surgery. It's almost closed. I've really never seen this before. He said, I'm a cardiologist. I've been doing this a really long time, and I've never seen this before. And my sister looked at me, and we looked, talked back and forth, and she said, well, I know why it happened. We've been praying. Our entire home county, Pope County, it was in the paper. Everybody's been praying for her. Every church in our community's been praying for her. Our Saviors was praying for her. God helped us see that. We weren't happy. We didn't like that path, and we didn't like that plan. We thought there was always something wrong. Why are we continually canceling these surgeries? He had a plan all along. She didn't need it. We just didn't know it at the time.
And Alicia is a nurse, so as her niece was going through all of this, you were having conversations with your sister being that, and so you knowing, why are we pushing this off again? Come on. And then, God knew it was going to heal on its own. So what's something that feels holy to you that other people might not assume is holy?
Well, when our kids were much littler, I'd probably tell you about 7 or 8 o'clock in the evening. Those of you with little kids, I'm sure, can relate. When they go to bed and the house is quiet, It usually was a disaster, so I'd go downstairs or somewhere where I couldn't see the mess, but that was holy to me because it was quiet. My husband was a police officer at the time. He worked nights, so a lot of times he was gone to work, and it was my time, which I didn't get a lot of, and that for me was just peaceful and reflective and really holy. Now, I would say it's any time I'm seeing the kids doing something that brings them joy and passion. We call it the three B's in our house. We have bowling, band, and baseball. Never would have imagined I'd be a bowling mom and spend thousands of hours in a bowling alley, but I am, and I love it. And those are the moments where you just really have to take that step back and soak it in. Our kids have done amazing things, from managing sports to being part of teams and meeting new friends and trying things out that I never would have thought, but that was God's plan for them, and soak it in. It's pretty holy.
Nice. How does your chosen scripture speak to your life of faith?
Probably not a huge surprise to those of you that know me. I'm pretty type A. I think Maria can relate.
That's really shocking. I can't relate at all.
Maybe a little stubborn, and I like things planned ahead. I didn't plan to cry. I didn't cry the first service, so, you know. Sometimes, though, it's really easy to feel frustrated or defeated when you think you have it figured out or you've got a plan and it doesn't go how you think it should go. And we really need that reminder that it's not our choice, it's not our plan, it's God's. And we have to listen to him and take those nudges. There was a saying that I had read once that, you know, if God has shut the door, stop picking the lock. I used to be a lock picker. I think I still am sometimes, but not as much as I used to be. That door is closed for a reason. Talking about planning things out, Dustin and I met on a 911 call. He was working for the sheriff's department, and I was working on the ambulance. I was in my last year of nursing school, very determined to finish because I wanted to work. I was sick of clinicals and all the fun that comes along with being in school, and we met on a 911 call on an accident scene, and somebody we know in common came up to me later that day and said, "Hey, did you see that deputy? I think he likes you." And I was like, good for him. I got stuff to do. I'm trying to get through school. I'm working two jobs. Like, I don't have time for that. That was not my plan. But it was God's. And that was 25 years ago and three kids and two houses. So he had a plan. I didn't think it was the plan, but it was. So let him make your plans and follow your heart.
Well said. As you look back at the scope of your faith life, what's something that's been life-giving for you?
I think not just always necessarily a specific moment, but similar to that story of how Dustin and I met, that when you look back at that, you made a decision, just thinking about how it really was that nudge, or, you know, you think, oh, it was your gut, or you made a good informed decision. It's not. It's God. He's telling us all along where we need to go, and just feeling that relief of power or of prayer and the power that comes with praise and prayer, it just is very fulfilling to me. And this church, it's pretty life-giving for our family. All of the things, the different ways that we've been connected or felt connected, all of the relationships we've built, I'm pretty sure we get more out of it than we give.
Well, and you're such, each member of your family gives life to this place and this community. So now I'm going to try not to cry. Okay, lightning round. Fun lightning round. Here we go. Purple or green grapes?
Red. I don't like the purple ones.
Okay, that's fair. Fair. Dragons or unicorns?
Definitely dragons. And back to like things well organized. I don't like glitter, so I don't want to clean up glitter from unicorns. So dragons.
Yeah. That's excellent. Beach or mountains?
Mountains, as long as I don't have to deal with the snow.
Yeah. What's your favorite sandwich?
That would definitely be my mom's Sloppy Joe's on our hometown bakery buns. There are no buns that can beat the little bakery that I grew up with.
Nice. What's your favorite smell?
Being a farm girl, no, it's not the barn, but it is fresh cut hay. It is always something that just brings me back instantly to my childhood.
Yeah, that's better than the alternative. What's one question you really want to ask Jesus?
I would ask him if my grandpa is still straightening old barns and building houses in heaven. He was the first family member I recall losing as a child. I was 12, and he was in his mid-60s, and he passed away suddenly, and he was a contractor. And his niche was straightening old barns. And I would love to know if he's still doing that up there and how many people are appreciating him like we did down here.
The nice thing is one day we'll get to find out.
Can't wait.
Yeah. What's a remarkable gift you've received from God?
Even though there's days I question this, I definitely say our kids. They really are a gift. They're unique talents. Sometimes it's challenging being a parent or exhausting. But they are a gift, and they are God's gift to us. And going back to just soaking in those moments, there's days, I'm sure, as many others can relate, you've been standing on the sidelines, cheering on multiple games, helping with hours of homework, Googling how to do certain math problems or other weird things, but just taking in those moments and really reflecting on how they are a gift and unique in their own special ways.
Well, thank you, Alicia, for sharing a little bit of your journey and how you thought maybe you had some plans and God had different plans for you, especially those unexpected ones that that have turned out so well. Maybe God knows what he's doing.
Maybe.
Yeah, we got to stop picking the locks. That was a good one. All right.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
I asked Alicia what song she would like to sing, if there was one that the band does that is meaningful to her, and she picked this song, Praise, and she said, it's one of those songs that just gets to me. The lyrics in verse 2 are very meaningful to me. And the lyrics are, I'll praise when I feel it, and I'll praise when I don't. I'll praise because I know you're still in control. And praising, even when you don't feel like it, when you feel like things are out of control, God's got it, and prayer and praise will get us through. And as hard as it is, we need to just let God be in control. So as a church family, let's sing together Praise.
I'll praise in the valley, praise on the mountain. I'll praise when I'm sure, praise when I'm doubting. I'll praise when unnumbered, praise when surrounded. 'Cause praise is the water, exciting, he's drowning. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. I'll praise when I feel it, praise when I don't.
Let's all stand up. Here we go.
I'll praise 'cause I know.
Praise the Lord, oh my. God's who sovereign, praise God's who reign, praise God's who rose and defeated the grave. Oh, praise God's who faithful, praise God's who's true, praise God's there's nobody greater than you.
Here we go.
Oh, praise God's who sovereign, praise God's who reign, praise God's who rose and defeated the grave. Oh, praise God's who faithful, praise God's who true, praise God's there's nobody greater than you.
Ourselves and our world. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for walking with us throughout our lives, shining a light on our path and giving each of us a story to share. Use us to bring healing to your world in whatever way you've gifted us to do. Lord, we pray for the leaders of nations. Where peace seems far off, bring it near. Where justice seems fleeting, bring it to light. Where discord seems relentless, bring harmony. We pray for the health and the well-being of our family, friends, and neighbors. Give courage to all those who struggle with addiction. Give healing and tender care to those who are sick or recovering from surgery. We name before you Andrea, Karen, Sharon, Linda, Corey, Sandy, Sandra, Ardell, Dolores, Mert, Kelly, Pastor Margie, Jovita, Pat, and David. We pray for this gathered community and for the faith communities represented this past week at the ELCA Youth Gathering. Nurture the faith of young people as they encounter new experiences and people. Walk with the 14 youth and adults from our Saviors and all those who are returning home from the Youth Gathering amid travel disruptions. Please bring them home safely and soon. We pray for those who mourn. Lorelei Burtson and family at the death of her husband Terrence. Becky and Al Beck at the death of Becky's mother, Helen. Rick and Julie Anderson at the death of their niece, Gina. Jared and Christy Von Dalen at the death of Jared's father, Vernon. And John Bublitz and Audrey Lundstrom at the death of John's mother, Norma. Remind them that nothing can separate us from your love in Jesus Christ, and comfort them with your sure promise of eternal life. Hear all of our prayers, God, those spoken out loud and those that we hold quiet within our hearts. We trust that you hear us for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Well, as you see up on the screen, a group of youth and adults from our Saviors have been in New Orleans with over 16,000 other youth from around the country at the ELCA's Youth Gathering, which was held last week. They worshiped together in a stadium, they heard inspiring speakers, met new people, and served the local community. And you know that computer glitch that kind of impacted computers around the world? Guess where they still are? They are still in New Orleans, so they are having even more new experiences. The group is fantastic, they're in good spirits, and they are in good hands. They're in God's hands. Alicia is there, and she's so talented, and we've got the other adults on the trip, fabulous, with good connections to airlines, so hopefully we'll get them home soon. So.
All of your offerings, all of our offerings together make youth ministry possible. You heard how impactful being at a youth gathering was for Alicia when she was a teenager. I got to go to one too. It's huge to be in a stadium of thousands of other teenagers and know you're not the only one. You're not the only teenager of faith out there. There are many ways you can give. You can place offering in the baskets on the stands on the way out, mail in a check, use the QR code on the announcements or on the screen, or give through the website. And as we consider our offerings this morning, we listen to a musical one from our business administrator, Amy Werder.
What you need, but you keep on searching. I've done all the work, but you keep on working. When you're running on empty and you can't find the remedy, just come to the well. You can spend your whole life chasing what's missing, but that empty inside, it's just not gonna listen. Nothing can satisfy, and the world leaves you high and dry. Just come to the well. And all who thirst will thirst no more, and all who search will find what their souls long for. The world will try, but it can never fill. So leave it all behind and come to the well. So bring me your heart, no matter how broken. Just come as you are when your last prayer is spoken. Just rest in my arms a while, and you'll feel the change, my child, when you come to the well. And all who thirst will thirst no more, and all who search will find what their souls long for. The world will try, but it can never fail. So leave it all behind, come to the well. Now that you're full of love beyond measure, your joy's gonna flow like a stream in the desert. Soon all the world will see that living water is found in me, 'cause you've come to the well. And all who thirst will thirst no more, and all who search will find what their souls long for. The world will try, but it can never fail. So leave it all behind and come to the well. Leave it all behind and come to the well.
Thank you, Amy. I have to say that you being on staff here, that's one of those things that was clearly God's plan. Like, people were applying, she was a late applicant who was exactly the right person, and so, yay, thank you. Let's pray as we give thanks to God for all good gifts.
God of field and forest, sea and sky, you are the giver of all good things. Give us glad and generous hearts that you might provide for those in need and bring healing to the world through us. Amen. Well, as we prepare to celebrate Holy Communion together this morning, please know that all are welcome to receive communion here at Our Savior's. And we'll explain a little bit more about how that happens in just a moment. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." We remember him as we pray the prayer he taught. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. If you're coming forward for communion, you'll see when the servers are ready at the front of your section. When you see that they're ready, that is your cue to start coming forward, beginning with the people in the front. When you reach your communion station, simply hold out your hands. We'll drop a wafer into your hands. Take that wafer and step to the next server who's holding the chalice. Dip your wafer into the chalice. The large section has red wine. The small section has white grape juice. After you've dipped your wafer, you may then eat it and return to your seat. If you need a gluten-free wafer, those are available at the front of each section, and there's more information in your weekly announcement sheet. If center sections, you'll come up the center and return by the side aisles. Side sections, you'll come up along the wall and back by those side aisles. If you have someone with you who doesn't take communion, please have them come forward for a blessing. And I think that's what you need to know. So for those communing in place or at home, hear these words as you receive the meal. The body of Christ is given for you, and the blood of Christ is shed for you. At this time, I invite the communion servers forward.
To this I hold, my shepherd.
Please stand as you are able. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Let us pray. Generous God, thank you for feeding us at your holy table. Send us now, strengthened by this meal, to leave a mark on this world, speaking out with courage, breaking down divisions, building bridges of understanding, and serving others in your name. Amen. The blessing of God, whose fingerprints are everywhere, whose love has marked us with the cross of Christ, who journeys with us and speaks to us still, be upon you now and forever. Amen.
1, 2, 3, 4.
I'm moving forward.
Thanks be to God. One, two, three, four.